Tonight and turn to, we're back in the book of Corinthians, but actually to the first chapter. So 1 Corinthians chapter 1, we'll look at verses 7 through 10 tonight. You could entitle it agreeing for the gospel's sake or unity for the gospel's sake. And you'll see why again when we start digging into it in just a moment. But if you will, before we get into the text, before we read, let's bow together, if you will, in a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we do come together and thanking you for this opportunity to gather in your name. And we just pray again, we know what you have done for us. We know the salvation that you have given us through your Son. We know that you have drawn us together into one body to have fellowship with you. And you do indeed for us to have fellowship and unity with one another. We pray that you would increase us in unity, that you would increase us in love even tonight again. And may all in all that your will would be done through the preaching of your word, that you would help us to submit and to obey your word tonight. We pray if there's anyone here that's lost, that they would be saved as well before it's too late. And it's in Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. Again, if you will, look to 1 Corinthians 1. We'll look at verse 7, and again, we'll go through 10. We'll read the verses first, and then again, we'll just dig a little bit deeper into the text. It says here, so that ye come behind in no gift, awaiting for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, who shall also confirm you unto the end, that ye may be blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful, by whom ye were called unto the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that ye all speak the same thing, and that there be no divisions among you, but that ye be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. Again, just pause here for just a moment, and we'll go back and look at the verses leading. We won't go into the verses leading up to these verses, but again, he's really just opening the letter of this book and letter to the church at Corinth. And then, though, he kind of, as we just started out in verse 7, he really is saying this in verse 7, that the Lord has given you gifts. That again, you would not go and run this race without gifts that are needed for you to run this race. While you, if you will, are waiting for the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. And again, we looked at one of those gifts today. One, there's other spiritual gifts that God has given. There's other opportunities that God gives us, other abilities, other resources that God gives us. And listen, that's all by his grace. And he wants us to use them in our race. Amen. He wants us to use them within the body, as we talked about this morning, to edify fellow believers as well. But even we're talking specifically about love this morning. And we are to, through love or by love, serve one another. Amen. So may we have that attitude within the church to have a, what can I do for you? How can I serve you and meet your need attitude? But really, verse 7, it says this, that God has seen fit to give us these gifts, that you would not again run the race, or that you would not wait for the coming without these gifts. That's a blessing, amen? But know that. So that's a few good things we already see that God has done for us. And really, in verses 7 through 9, we're going to see what God has done for us. And this isn't all of what God has done for us. And then in verse 10, we're going to see now what we are to do since he has done that for us. Amen. But again, verse 7, he's given you gifts. He also has given us this hope as we wait for the coming of the Lord. Amen. What a great mission and task and hope for us today. Amen. Again, we're not like a world that has no hope. We're not like a world that just knows that death is coming and that judgment is coming after. Listen, believer, if you are in Christ, you are waiting on the Lord, waiting for him to come in his splendor, come in his glory. You're waiting to see him face to face. Amen. You are waiting for eternity to come. And again, that's what we have. That's what we're looking forward to. And then it says, who shall also confirm you. Speaking of even the Lord Jesus Christ, it says that that he will confirm us. What does this mean? He will keep you, and he will even keep you strong. Amen. We talked about that tonight, that we are kept by Christ. Amen. We talk about the security of the believer tonight in our BTC lesson. What a blessing from Almighty God. Amen. Do you know tonight that once you trust in Christ, you are forever his. He will confirm you unto the end. He will keep you unto the end. Amen. And he also has the ability to keep you strong unto the end. Amen. He wants to lift you up and to strengthen you in his strength and to keep you going forward in the race until that blessed day that you see him face to face. And then it also says, and so that's another gift even there, but then it also says, until the end, that ye may be blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. Do you know that since you repented of sin and trusted in Christ, do you know that for you, it is going to go extremely different for you in the day that the Lord comes back than it will for everyone else? Amen. In the world. What a blessed privilege. Listen, there is going to be two ways that people will stand before the Lord. One will be in judgment. One will be in condemnation. And that is for all who have remained in their sin and have rejected Christ. But for all who have repented of sin and trusted in Christ, listen, it says here that he will present us blameless. Amen. This means that he is going to present you and declare you justified and right before God. Amen. I'm going to tell you, that's where my trust is right now. My trust in being declared righteous before God is not in myself. It's not in any good thing that I could do. It's not in that. Amen. It is in Christ and Christ alone. And if you have trusted in Christ, listen, there's coming a day where he is going to present you unto the Father blameless, amen, justified, declared righteous before God, amen. Do you know that you and I have that coming? It's even getting good already. All of what God has done for us. Verse 9, it says God is faithful, amen. All of what God just said he is going to do through Christ, even for you already, but also for you in the future. It is all because God is faithful. Amen. That could go into a deep study about the faithfulness of Almighty God. Amen. There's times where you and I, we are not faithful as we should be to God. Amen. We're not. But with God, listen, God is always faithful. We have entered into a covenant relationship with God through Jesus the Son. And listen, nothing at all will separate you from that love. Amen. God has faithfulness that cannot be compared with anyone else. Amen. But another gift from God, his faithfulness to us. And then it says, by whom ye were called unto the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Again, he's telling us right here that ye have been called into this fellowship with Christ. You and I, again, we're not standing alone before a holy and perfect God. We're standing before him, joined together with Christ. Amen. When God looks at us, he sees the righteousness of his Son. And when he sees us, he accepts us because of his Son. But that's a blessed privilege that we can be in fellowship, in unity, that we can be one with Christ. Amen. And then he goes on to say this. That's what God has done for us. And that's just scratching the surface. Amen. That's just some of what God has done, what he is doing, and what he is faithful to do for you and I through Christ. But listen, he says this, now I beseech you. So after we've seen what God has done, and we see this constantly throughout the Word of God, that God presents us with doctrine, with truth, with theology. He presents us with what all he has done. And then it goes into now calling you to do something even in service to him. Amen. And amongst each other. That's exactly what's happening here. Now, in light of what he has done for you, I beseech you. I urge you. Again, the Apostle Paul is writing and inspired of the Holy Spirit of God. And he is urging the believers at Corinth, but also us, amen. God is urging you and I to do this. It says, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, right? In light of what the Lord has done, but also in the authority of his name, amen. This is the word of God. So by the Lord's authority, what are we being besieged and urged to do? It says this, that ye all speak the same thing, and that there be no divisions among you, but that ye be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. Amen. It's all about unity here. What did he just talk about? That we have fellowship with who? With Christ. So since we have been placed in Christ, since we have fellowship with Christ, since we have unity for Christ and everything else that God has done for us that he just said, in light of that, God is now calling you and I to have fellowship with each other. Amen. Do you know that, again, Christ, even as he was the very next day, and he was very well aware of it, amen, if you recall when he was in the garden and when he was in this much grief that he was going through, he knew what was coming the next day. He was even going to be betrayed that very night by one of his own. But he was going to go through these false trials and persecutions, and then he was going to be offered up in suffering and crucifixion the very next day. Do you know what he did? Even for us. One, he prayed even for the apostles that were there before him that he had spent these three and a half years with. Amen. But then he didn't stop there. Do you know that he also then prayed for believers to come? Amen. He said, but I don't pray for just these. I pray for the ones that are coming. And what did he even pray for? That they would be one as we are one, he said. Just as Jesus and the Father are one, that they're in unity. They're in unity. They are in fellowship. He also prayed that believers even to come, that we would also be in unity. Amen. You know that that's the desires of the Lord today for you and me. And I'll tell you, there will be different things that will come throughout life. You maybe have realized things within your past, with your time in church, maybe where the enemy has tried to drive wedges within the church. Amen. It's happened. Amen. It has. The enemy is all too prone to not only attack from outside, but even attack within, trying to cause division even within. But you and I, we need to be reminded what God's will for us as a body is. Amen? It's to be in unity. It's to be undivided. It's to be in unison. He says that you speak the same thing. That there be no divisions among you. That it says that you be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. That we would have, that last verse said that we would have the same thought, that we would have the same purpose. Amen. Is this calling for a uniformity that we all are going to think 100% alike? That we're all going to cut our hair the same way, that we're all going to drive the same car, that we're all going to wear the same clothes, whatever it may be. No, that's not what it's speaking about. It's not speaking about uniformity, but it is talking about unity. Amen. When it comes to what we're here for, when it comes to the Lord being magnified in what we do. Amen. When it comes to the Word of God being the absolute authority. Amen. In church life and in home life and in all of life, when it comes to us being dedicated to, as we talked about this morning, you could think about it this way, the greatest command to love God supremely with all your mind, heart, and soul, and to love your neighbor as ourselves. And when it comes to the Great Commission, amen, to win others to Christ and to go to do it. Amen. And then to teach everything that the Lord has taught us to all those who have gotten saved. Amen. Are those two greatest things, the greatest things within our thought and within our purpose in life. Amen. Listen, that should be what all of us have in common. Amen. That should be what draws us all together. And then it says, let no division be among you. It'll even talk about with the church at Corinth. Again, church of Corinth was dealing with spiritual immaturity, with carnality. Very selfish, right? But let me tell you, today we can be tempted to be selfish too. Amen. We talked about that this morning. How love is not selfish, not self-centered, but is others focused. Listen, for us as believers, we can still be tempted to be selfish, for us to want to get our way with our solution. Always we think has to be the very best, ultimate solution to it all. But listen, no, let there be no division among you. Again, at times do we have the same exact idea concerning every single thing? No. However, we are never to have division to where we split apart. We're never to have division to where we are then opposed to one another. It should never be a us against them. Amen. Those are examples of division. But God says this, now I urge you, don't let that be any, really named among you. Amen. Don't let there be any division among you. If you will, I'll just end with reading this verse, these verses here. Philippians 1:27 says this, only let your conversation be as it becometh the gospel of Christ, that whether I come and see you or else be absent. Again, Paul's speaking, and he's saying that, look, if I'm there with you, or if I'm just hearing about your spiritual condition from someone else, look, he says this, I may hear of your affairs, again, what's going on with you, that ye stand fast in one spirit, amen, and with one mind or one purpose, striving together for the faith of the gospel. Do you and I want that to forever be said about us? Amen. Do you want that to forever be said about Bethel, is that we are standing fast in one spirit, that we're standing fast in one mind and one purpose. And what's that purpose? It just said it, that we're striving together. Amen. Not striving against, not working so hard against or working so hard to get our way. No, we're striving together. We're working together, even fighting together. For what? For the faith of the gospel. Amen. That we're striving and working to do what? To proclaim the gospel, to live the gospel, to serve the Lord until he comes, to teach his word here, to preach and proclaim his gospel out there. Amen. I hope and pray that we will forever want that to be said about us. Amen. And the only way that that's going to happen is if we stay focused on that and have that in unison and be driven and give our full effort towards that, and that we don't let any division ever come amongst us. Amen. If you will, we'll end the service in a time of prayer. If we'll end our live feed and